Please welcome the Grace Hopper Celebration 2013 General Co-Chair, Fatma Mealy.
Good morning. Thank you all for being here this morning. I am very honored to be introducing the keynote speaker today, Dr. Valerie E. Taylor. Yesterday's keynote speaker, Megan Smith, said, and I'm rephrasing, "Much in life depends on who you happen to walk with." She then advised, "Pick an amazing and cool person, hang out with them, and watch extraordinary things happen." If I were to put that advice into practice, Valerie Taylor would be number one on my list of cool and amazing people I'd love to hang out with and walk along with. If I can keep up with her pace, that is. This is a fast walking woman. Let's start with some facts. Valerie Taylor is a very successful academic. She received a bachelor and a master's degree in computer engineering from Purdue University, and a PhD in EECS from University of California, Berkeley. She joined the faculty of Northwestern University, and then she moved to Texas A&M as the computer science and engineering chair of the Roy Wisenbaker Professor. In 2011, she became Senior Associate Dean of Academic Affairs in the Dwight Luke College of Engineering. Her research work is in the area of modeling and performance of parallel and distributed applications. She has maintained a very active and successful research program, even as she held administrative positions. And believe me, that is a feast. Dr. Valerie Taylor's life and career also are a high-performance system with well-balanced multiple threads. She is the mother of two teenagers, Theodore, 16, and Jasmine, 13, and she's really enjoying their teenage years. She enjoys bowling and roller skating, another balancing act. What Dr. Taylor has accomplished for her career and family is outstanding, but she did not stop there. She is one of those leaders that Liz Wiseman calls a multiplier, people who make everyone around them smarter and more successful. And by the way, Liz Wiseman will be giving a talk this afternoon about her book. It's a wonderful book. So. Looking through Dr. Taylor's biography, I realized this is what a multiplier is. So this leads me to the third thread. Dr. Taylor has a passion for diversity and a commitment to see others around her reach their potential. She's a very familiar face in Grace Hopper. She has chaired it in 2002 and served in the steering committee for years. She held leadership positions in the ACM-CRA IEEE Coalition for Diversity in Computing. She is also the co-founder and co-chair of the TAPIA Conference for Diversity in Computing. Her latest initiative is Commend IT, the Center for Minorities and People with Disabilities in Information Technology. In the past two days, I have been asking around me for, everyone around me knows Valerie Taylor, so I have been asking for information about her. And the reaction I get from everyone is that of admiration for her energy and determination. Valerie Barr, chair of ACMW last night, said, "I go to sleep one day, I get up in the morning and boom, Valerie Taylor has created Commended IT and has it up and running. The woman is a force. She gets things done." And that pretty much sums up what everybody else has told me. So without further ado, please help me welcome Valerie Taylor. الدول.
Thank you very much for the wonderful introduction. And I first have to say thank you also for mentioning my children. They're teenagers, so of course I have to mention Theodore and Jasmine, the love of my life, my children, that also balance me. And so today it's a great pleasure to be here and an honor to talk about something for which I have great passion, and that is diversity. So today I'm going to talk about a case for diversity. And I'm going to discuss my journey to truly embracing diversity. So I'll talk about my experiences and share what I've learned in terms of the journey. First, I want to start off talking about the Grace Hopper Conference, and that is the 1994 Grace Hopper Conference, which is the first one. So I want to take a poll to ask how many of you attended the first Grace Hopper Conference, if I can get a show of hands. So I know it's not going to be many, because the first conference, there were 600 attendees. So it's wonderful to see the conference be at 4,800. So first, I want to take this opportunity to congratulate Telly and ABI for the evolution of the Grace Hopper Conference over the years. So congratulations. With attending the first Grace Hopper Conference, it resulted from a visit to Anita Borg, who at that time was at the DEC Western Research Lab in Palo Alto. And I was visiting Anita because of research. So I was doing work related to the DEC Alpha, and that the DEC Alpha chip. And I had met Anita when I was a graduate student at UC Berkeley. So Anita came to Berkeley, and she, at that time, was talking about sisters. But later on, around 1994, I was doing work in computer architecture, and I contacted Anita to see if I could visit her about the work. And we had a conversation, and we talked about Grace Hopper. But we also talked about underrepresented groups. And in particular, we talked about having a subgroup of sisters that would be devoted to sisters of color. So Anita at that time said, how about if we have a BOF at the Grace Hopper Conference that's about sisters of color? So we did. We had a BOF that night with the Grace Hopper Conference, and it was about 10 to 15 women in a room talking about starting Sisters of Color, which was wonderful. At the Grace Hopper Conference, we also had dancing, which was wonderful. And it was the first time I had attended a conference that was technical, and yet at the end of the evening, we all danced and had a great time. It was truly wonderful. But when we talk about the Sisters of Color, so we did go on to start the Sisters of Color. It was a small listserv. It wasn't much activity. And let me say, at that time, the Grace Hopper Conference was every 3 years. So the next one in 97, we had another Women of Color, BOF. But then we went on, 2000, we had one. Then Grace Hopper went to every 2 years. So it was 2002. 2004 in Chicago was the first time we had a Women of Color luncheon. It was really amazing to have that luncheon, where at that time for the luncheon, it was over 100 participants in the Women of Color luncheon. So we had grown from 15 in a bar to over 100 in terms of a luncheon in 2004 in Chicago. So it's really wonderful to see today where there are many different communities within the Hopper Conference, within the Anita Borg Institute. So we have the Latinas in computing, we have Black women in computing, we have lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender women in computing, Turkish women in computing, and Arab women in computing. Truly wonderful in terms of the diversity. We also have the Underrepresented Women in Computing Group, or UWIC, which represents traditionally underrepresented groups and also women with a disability. So it's truly great to actually see the diversity that exists. And so while there are differences with the groups, there are some commonalities. And I just want to give you an example. So at the Grace Hopper Conference that was held in San Diego, there was also a large Women of Color luncheon. And even to this conference, we had a Women of Color luncheon yesterday. And so in San Diego, during the luncheon, we had a discussion with the different tables, and we talked about issues. And it was very interesting because one issue that came up had to do with language, where a woman from India talked about a language, and sometimes people make comments on how it's hard to understand with an accent. And just as she said that, a woman from Alabama stood up and said, "I encounter the same thing, where sometimes with the Southern accent, people say it's hard to understand." So when you start to look at different communities, while there are some differences, as we get together, we find that there are some commonalities in terms of issues, which is wonderful. When we start to look at diversity, I just want to take this opportunity to define what is meant by cultural diversity. And I've been reading a book entitled Understanding Cultural Diversity in Today's Complex World. And in the book, it defines diversity as a culture of human behavior that honors people where they are, with what they know, how they acquired this knowledge, and how they apply it. So reading that and understanding especially the part about honor, and what does that really mean in terms of embracing diversity? So when I look at that, over the years, I've made many mistakes. I've had different things that occur. And so as you reflect on that journey, I've come to some conclusions that I would like to share with you in terms of what I've learned. And what I've learned has to do with three things that are important with respect to diversity. First being engaged, and that is taking the time to learn about others. When we talk about honoring what a person knows and their background and experiences, I've learned that it takes time to get to know a person. And I'll give you some examples. So with the Grace Hopper Conference in 94, I attended. For 97, I was asked to be on the program committee for the Grace Hopper in 97. At the end of the 97 conference, Telly and Anita approached me about being program chair for Grace Hopper 2000. So when Telly and Anita approach you, you can only say yes. But I remember we had a meeting in Palo Alto, and it was a meeting with Telly, with Anita, Kathy Richardson, and myself. And so we were talking about the program. So I remember getting to the meeting, and it was held at Anita's home. And so I get there, and I'm thinking, okay, we're going to talk through the program, how it should be laid out. And so Anita says, "Let's go for a hike." Okay, I'm from Chicago, and when I go on a hike, we're planning for the hike. You know, you get your clothes, you have your snacks, you're prepared, you may do some warm-up, okay? So Anita says, "Let's go for a hike." And I'm going, "I don't know if I'm quite dressed for a hike, but, you know, let's go for a walk." So we go for a walk. And Anita's asking, "So tell me about yourself. You know, I'm Valerie Taylor. I'm a, you know, assistant professor at Northwestern." She goes, "No, you know, you have sisters and brothers. You know, tell me about your background. Tell me about yourself." As we walk along, and you know, being from Chicago, not having gone hiking much, you know, I'm looking going, is it poison ivy out here? Do I need to worry about that? But in any case, you know, Anita's asking all of these questions. And so later on, I realized it was Anita learning about me and learning about me from an in-depth perspective, learning about me culturally, learning about my background. She asked about my parents. She asked about my siblings. She asked about my personal life, and it was wonderful. And so when we got back to the house, and I was saying at that time, I had been active with conferences, and in particular, the supercomputing conference. And so she said, so tell me about the supercomputing conference. How does it work? What do they do? And so then when we start to talk about the program with respect to the Grace Hopper Conference, I began to see that she embraced my background. She embraced my whole self. So there was the first stage of engagement, and we went out, and that was through hiking and conversation, but there was also this stage of embracing that background and asking that it come to the forefront. So we spent time talking about the program, and I would mention some things that were done with the supercomputing conference and other conferences, and I would mention some things about my background, and it was truly wonderful. It was a very engaging experience. The next part that I've learned has to do with enhancement, that once you engage and get to know people, there's also the enhancement that comes from that embracement. And that is usually at the end, when you embrace others, you end up with something that's much greater than what you started with. And while people always say that, it doesn't always occur. Because sometimes you can be in a room and you can say, yes, I truly have diversity with the representation in the room, but then you isolate people by not embracing what they have to say, not embracing their background or dismissing it. So that part of first engaging to learn about a person, then embracing, and then the enhancement comes. And I have to say that engagement, I began to realize Anita did it very well and very subtle. So I've had engagement where one time in grad school at Purdue, at that time my advisor only had three grad students. It was myself, a white male, and a male from India. And so the white male, we were talking one day and he came over and I said, oh yes, I'm from Chicago. He immediately said, are you from the projects? And I said, well, it's, you know, it's fine to be from the projects, but no, I'm not from the projects, you know. He goes, oh, okay. And then he said, are you first generation? And I said, no, I know many that are first generation. I go, but I'm not first generation. And so then he said, you know, Chicago, you hear about a lot of the gangs. He goes, did you have to worry about gangs? I know about gangs, but no. And so later on, he came back and he said, so Valerie, what is your background? And he said, I'm really sorry at the way I approached you, but that's all I knew. And so I told him, I said, well, you know, the fact that you're willing to have the conversation and you're willing to actually be open to hear about my background, I'm happy. So I went on to tell him about my background, that I grew up, my parents have degrees, my mother has a teaching, she has a degree of master's in education, and my father is an engineer, so I always consider myself as the combination of the two. And I have an older brother and sister, and my father started a company when I was young. And so you get to know about starting things. So he started a telecommunications company. And so after that dialogue, I also asked him about his background and got to know him. And we became good friends as we learned how to engage. And that language for engagement, I want to say, comes from different type of experiences. But one such experience that has been very meaningful is that of mediation training. So when I arrived at Texas A&M as department head, which was a bit scary because you go from being a faculty member to now leading a department, which is very different. So I was asked to attend, well, actually strongly encouraged to attend mediation training. At that time, I thought, okay, mediation between conflicting parties, and you're trying to come up with a solution. But what I learned after attending the 40 hours is that mediation training is really about how to navigate two people in conflict to come up with their own solution. Because if people do not take ownership of the solution, it's not going to occur. So as a mediator, you actually don't propose a solution. The two parties have to propose a solution, and if they don't, then so be it, but that's not on you to propose that solution. And what I learned is actually three things from the mediation training that really becomes important in terms of engagement. And that is, conflict is usually about emotions and how some action made you feel. And that's actually a big deal for me because I'm very logical. A to B to C, you know, so there's no emotion, you know. A, next step B, next step C, why do you have to have these feelings in there? So, you know, if it's logical, why not get to C? But then I had to learn about this, the emotions and how something makes you feel. And I'm kind of going, but that's not logical. Why do you feel that way? But then you actually have to take the time to get to know the history that actually led up to the emotion. Another thing that I learned had to do with language, and that of having what I call neutral language, and looking at the adjectives that you use with respect to language. And it's not to say that you don't use adjectives, but you watch the adjectives that you use. So for example, if you tell someone, oh, that was a good question, and then the next person, you go, that was an excellent question, thank you for asking. Then you kind of go, oh, maybe I did differentiate. So then I learned with my language, that was a good question, that was a good question, good question. So I'm using my adjectives, but I'm watching in terms of how I'm using it and the language that I'm using. And then the third thing I learned from mediation was that of listening. And I thought I was a good listener. And you think listening, I get to the highlight, okay? You mentioned this. But then I learned in mediation training with listening, you need to repeat what someone said. And I go, oh, but you mentioned something about this. And I go, but that's not what I said. And I go, okay. So I learned in terms of listening meant I had to repeat what they said. And then it became clear what it really means to listen. So with those three of understanding emotions come into conflict, and emotions come into meetings and discussions, having neutral language and listening and not having that judgmental in terms of the language, but you're also listening to what people have to say, that becomes really important when you're talking about engaging someone to learn about culture, to learn about background, and to learn about experiences. So, and I'll give a few examples. So here's a project, it's MUMI, and so it stands for Multiple Metrics Modeling Infrastructure, okay? So we're not the best with acronyms, so it's, and this is a research project, it's funded by the National Science Foundation. So it's about $2.5 million, and it's a project that's a collaboration with Texas A&M, Virginia Tech, University of Tennessee in Knoxville, and University of Texas in El Paso. So the four collaborators, we look at doing performance and power modeling, because when you look at, let's say, the future of high-performance computing, power becomes an issue. Because even the latest supercomputer, where the top supercomputer is from China, it utilizes 17 megawatts for the computer. So if you're talking about future computers, power becomes a big issue. So with this project, we're looking at performance and power. We look across different applications ranging from high energy physics, weather modeling, earthquake simulations, ocean modeling, structural analysis. So it's truly diverse in terms of what we're looking at. What happens a lot in terms of the applications that we're working with is we have to take time first to get to know each other's background and to come up with a common language. So when we're working with application developers in a group, we have to first spend time engaging in the discussion. Then we go to embracing and then enhancement. But I want to give two examples that relate to culture. So with my background and growing up, my mom always said, let's make do with what we have. We may not have much, but we don't need much. We make do with what we have. So now I bring that to the research. In this work, we develop performance models. And sometimes we have discussions, and we'll say, what do we need to ask of the application developer? And all of a sudden, I find myself going, we don't need to ask much. We can make do with what we have in terms of developing the models. But then there will be others in the group that are starting to say, but hey, my background is such that let's ask for what we need, because it may be the case we may get a yes or no, but ask for what we need. So we're all bringing these different backgrounds to the table. And then in the end, we end up with something middle ground. We may not ask so much of the user, because we may look at how much load and what's realistic to ask of the user, but then it's not where we're asking nothing of the user. So we'll ask middle ground and reaching that middle ground. Another example that comes up in terms of research with cultural background has to do with the notion of not questioning elders. So in my research group, I have students from various backgrounds. I have international students. And in some cases, I've learned that there's the notion of not questioning your elders. And in some cases, I'm considered the elder. So when we have a research meeting, I like questions, because that dialogue is what leads to something that I think is much better than a starting point. But if your cultural background is that you don't question elders, so now how do we actually embrace that and enhance it? So what I do in terms of sometimes with my research groups and my meetings, we actually have the students present with each other. And in that way, there's a feeling of comfort of asking questions of other students. We also, when we're having a discussion, I'll save my comments for last, because I recognize that if I start off with my comments, then in some cases it's taken as so and not questioned. And I don't claim to know the answer, but a lot of times I'm just raising a point. So I'll save it to last so that we can have a better dialogue and engagement so that everyone has an opportunity to speak and to be involved in the discussion. And that part is very important, to acknowledge that cultural background. For example, another example is through CMANDIT, the Center for Minorities and People with Disabilities in IT. We have a number of workshops that are focused on professional development. We have academic careers workshops, we have student professional development workshops, we have national lab workshops, and we're also, as Telly mentioned, the presenters of the TAPIA conference, and that's where CDC is the organizer and ACM is the sponsor. With our workshops, with CMANDIT, we look at underrepresented groups, African American, Native American, Hispanics, and also people with disabilities. We had to change how we were operating as a workshop to be inclusive. And this is thanks in large part to Richard Latner and the Access Computing Alliance. So now we look at starting off our workshops first with a discussion. Well, when we're talking about engaging and we have participants who are hearing impaired, we start off describing that when you're engaged in a conversation with someone who's hearing impaired, look at that person instead of looking at the interpreter, so that you're engaged in conversation with the individual. We also talk about with our slides that if your slides have a lot of words on them, before you start with the slide, wait a few minutes, because someone who is hearing impaired needs to first look at your slides, because after that, they're looking at the interpreter and not your slide. So having a few minutes before you talk with your slides gives them a chance to look at it. Then we also have moderated discussion. With respect to the moderated discussion, what we do is, in a group, we ask anyone, please raise your hand. We acknowledge you. We ask that you say your name, say your comment or question. And in this way, it's not this dynamic back and forth, but it gives everyone a chance to be truly engaged in a discussion. And we found having that, starting off with that discussion, provides a way for the workshop and the activities to be more engaging. And we've actually found that the participants say at the end that it was really good for everyone involved, which is wonderful. So those are some things in terms of the workshops, in terms of having those discussions. I also want to spend a little time talking about diversity in terms of the work environment. So as was mentioned, it's actually this past April that I became Senior Associate Dean of Academic Affairs. And so I had taken a sabbatical and I came back and now I'm in the Dean's office. And as Senior Associate Dean of Academic Affairs, I oversee undergraduate and graduate programs. And so all that relates to academics. So here's a picture in terms of the staff in the office. We also have 8 first-year faculty also with the Engineering Academic and Student Affairs Office, or ESA. With respect to this office, when I first came in, there was very little transition because I started and the person that was in that position took on a new position as well. And in her new position, things ramped up rapidly. And as a result, there was very little transition, and so I began to respond to things. But then I had to stop and realize I had not taken the opportunity to engage, to get to know all the staff in the area, in ESA, to take the time to go around and talk and have that engaging dialogue. Tell me a little bit about yourself. Tell me a little bit about your background. I don't have a chance to do like Anita and say, let's go out for a hike, but I can go by the office and find out about the individuals and the staff. So now, recognizing that initially I was in this mode of answering things, of responding. We were working together, but we were responding to things. And I would just ask, who needs to be involved in this and let's respond. But now I've taken some time, rearranged things, and looked at how to engage everyone in the unit. And so it's becoming a much better interaction, more fruitful, where I think people are starting to feel more comfortable with having an engaging dialogue, bringing their background fully into the workplace. And so I want to, and this is actually my last slide, because I want to spend a little time here, and that I want to end on a quote from Maya Angelou, but I want to tell you about what this quote means to me. So with the quote is, we all should know that diversity makes for a rich tapestry, and we must understand that all the threads of tapestry are equal in value, no matter what their color. This is truly wonderful, and it's inspiring because it says we all, in terms of a tapestry, and that is having some common goals of working together. But everyone brings unique experiences, brings unique background to that tapestry. So when I look out into the audience here at Grace Hopper, and you look around and you see the true diversity that exists here at the Hopper Conference, it's phenomenal. And each and every one of you brings something unique to the Hopper Conference. But you, it's more than that, because you bring something unique to the field of computing. And so we're all here today because of the strong need to increase women in computing. And with that, we all have something that we can add in terms of bringing and increasing the women and the diversity in computing. So I want to end my talk with a challenge to you. And that is a challenge to take the time that as you talk with each other, to take the time to engage each other in that dialogue. Engage each other to learn about each other, and that means learning in depth about their background and experiences. And then embracing that background and experiences of others, and then using what that new knowledge of those experiences to enhance what you're doing. And to think about that enhancement of what that would mean in the field of computing. It would truly be enhanced, and it is evolving with the enhancement as we add diversity to the field of computing. So with that, I thank you. And I think we have time for questions at the two microphones.
My name is Rashmi, and I'm from Amazon. First of all, thank you for that great talk. So my question is with respect to the engagement phase. Mm-hmm. I see two potential issues with it. One, from the asker's perspective, the other person's culture could consider these questions personal. Not all people are comfortable discussing their background and their family.
Okay. I'm sorry, but I can't hear all the questions. I can't hear the full question, so I don't know if it's a microphone, but if you could speak up, I'm sorry about that.
So my question is, when we ask people about their family and background, mm-hmm. how do we know that they're comfortable with those questions? And the second thing, when we speak about our background, how are we sure that the other person is going to embrace it and not subject us to some stereotype assumptions?
And those are excellent questions. And let me start with the first one in terms of asking someone about their background. So with respect to asking, there are some questions that you can ask. And in that way, you leave it open for a person to tell you what they feel comfortable. And so, for example, if you start off telling someone, tell me a little bit about yourself. And then based upon their response, you can delve deeper, because then that tell me about yourself is a way to start a dialogue. And that's just one way, because many people will have many different ways. But it's one way to start that dialogue. And then based upon what they tell you, it tells you what they feel comfortable talking about. And that's one way to start that conversation. When you have someone that approaches you in terms of a stereotype, and let's say it's the example that I had of approaching with the stereotype, there are a couple of ways. And that is, one way is to look at some education, okay? And I've even had some people that approach me with a stereotype where I've gone out and purchased a book. And I said, you might want to read this book, and then let's have a conversation. But it's a way to start a dialogue such that hopefully that stereotype will change. And it's not to say that it will, but at least it's starting a conversation and starting that dialogue. And in some cases, it can be frustrating where someone comes to you with a stereotype that you just feel like, I don't even want to be bothered, wasting my time. But then sometimes I have to stop myself and think, maybe this is a learning opportunity. This is an opportunity for education and to start the dialogue and continue the dialogue. Because sometimes I'll stop and say, if I just allow the stereotype to perpetuate and not even address it, it'll continue on to the next person. So sometimes I'll say to myself, let me take the opportunity to use this as a learning and give them more information. So I'll follow up and give them websites. I'll give them books. I'll say, you know, after you've read this book, let's have a conversation. So those are some different things.
Thank you.
Okay. And I think we go to, okay, Mike one.
Hi, my name is Jenny, and I'm in between projects. My question is that I'm in an area where there's really not a concentration of tech people like there is in Silicon Valley. And so equally, there's not as many women, and even more so, fewer or less diversity in the female population in computing. How can I help encourage high school and other women who are minority or not to consider computing? Because I find sometimes there are a lot of very jaded, diverse people of diversity who won't listen to me because I am a white woman, and so, which is its own stereotype, I guess. Mm-hmm. Like, why does she care about me?
Right.
So.
So I good question, and so but it's a good question. It is a good question. But I want to add to that, so that's a very good point in terms of resources and also geographical location. So I think there are resources that are available using technology, collaborative technology, where they're presenting videos. So you have like .diva that's presenting examples. You have different bios. So for example, if you look on the ABI website, you'll have bios of different people. With Latinas in computing, they often highlight Latina women that are doing work in computing. You have these different groups, CASI that's doing some work in that area, Commanded, we try to also highlight people that are doing work in the area. So it's these different websites that you can start to go to, and while they're videos, a lot of times there are contacts there. And the contacts will help in terms of, it may be where the person may start off with a phone call or with an email to others, but it's at least you're making that connection. And so I try to answer email, because I welcome email. I get a little overloaded, but I do try to answer the email because I think it's really important. And people answer my emails when I have questions, and they still answer my emails because I still have questions. So I do try to take that time, and I know many others do the same. So it's making that connections. So while you're here at the Hopper Conference, make some connections that you can also take back to the high school students.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Betsy. I'm a PhD.
And I'm just walking back and forth so I can better see you with the lights.
I'm Betsy. I'm a PhD student at Brown. Mike, I had really appreciate your ideas about improving communication and thinking about culture and background when you're communicating with someone. My question is, I'm not always in the power position in communication situations, you know, meetings, et cetera. But how could someone in like non-power situations control the conversation to be more inclusive culturally?
And here's, and this is what I've seen from my experiences, and that is, in terms of being in a meeting, I always look at the fact that if you are in a meeting, you are in a power position because you're there in the meeting. And so use that to raise a voice, to raise issues. So for example, I remember when we first started off with some of the academic careers workshops, It took someone in a meeting, and it was a participant saying, wait, you need to really do this to be engaging. That's not working for me. And so sometimes it takes that voice. And I realize each meeting is dynamic, and it's figuring out what's comfortable for you in terms of having that voice. But the fact that you are in a meeting and the fact that you are at the table gives you a strong voice to raise some issues. And even today, sometimes I have to push myself to raise that, you know, a voice about issues. Because, and I try to temper it and I go, okay, when is the right time to raise this issue? And so sometimes it may be a simple question of, you know, where you considered this, but did you consider this? And sometimes people, and especially when you bring up, you know, diversity, what did you consider? And I'll say cultural diversity. How are we doing with respect to cultural diversity? And then the question may be, I don't know. Then you just, how can we find out? How can we, you know, what can we do about this? So sometimes a simple question can lead to much discussion, but the fact that you're at a meeting gives you a strong voice to actually raise that question. But it does take, and I still grapple with that, it does take concerted effort to have that voice.
Thank you.
My name is Emily Ledbetter, and I'm a student at the University of Texas at Austin. My question was related to how you can approach someone who sees your diversity as something that's held you back, and it's something that you've somehow managed to overcome in order to be successful. How would you approach that if the person who feels that way is in a direct management role over you?
Right. I totally understand. And, you know, the issue that comes up, and it goes back to, I think, partly with the mediation and the conflict, you know, because sometimes a person will approach you in a way that's defensive, I'll say. Is that an issue? And the person is in power that's approaching you that makes you feel defensive? I just want to make certain I'm getting at the issue.
Well, I haven't experienced this recently. It was a number of years ago. But essentially, because I was a woman, he didn't want me to touch the code because he thought I would screw something up.
Mm-hmm. Right. And so the question that comes up is, you know, if you have access to the code, okay, and you can make a copy of the code, modify the code, show the wonderful enhancements that occurs with your modified code and what it can do, and bring that to the background and to the issue.
So that is what I did. Mm-hmm. But then he considered that I must be one of the good ones, and I was kind of wondering how you can address someone and make them see that it isn't just because you're one of the good ones, it's just because, I think other women could be just as good.
It's just because all women are fabulous.
Obviously.
So, but, and part of it, and I understand, because sometimes I get, and I have to share this story. So I when I was in high school, I did well in terms of my courses. And so they told me, they said, oh, you must be an anomaly, you know. And so you're special and you're gifted. And so I ran home and I told my mom, and I was like, Mom, they're saying these things. And so my mom went up there. She goes, she's special because she's Ollie Taylor's daughter, and that's the only reason why she's special. You know, each one of my children are special. But in any case, the issue that comes up a lot of times, especially when you're the only, people will say, well, is that an anomaly? You're special. But what I do is I go back and I give them a bunch of names. And I give them a bunch of websites, and I give them resources, and I go, no, this is not the case. As you can see, it's here, 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 and I'm happy to give you a lot more, and et cetera. And just so they know, no, this is not a one-off. This is not a case. This is in general. But it's taking that time to have that conversation. And it is giving them that information. And that's where sometimes you may refer them to a list of names because they may say it's a one-off. You may refer them to websites and go, here's a whole bunch of resources in that area. You may refer them to a book where you really need more in-depth knowledge. And I'll come back and say, you know, I'm happy to have a follow-up conversation about it, you know, about each one of these. Let me know when you're available.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, Valerie. Patty. Hi. Lopez.
Hi, Patty.
So at my company, we have a training. It's called Micro Inequities. And I spoke to a colleague, Raquel Romano, and she talked about special training in her company for implicit bias and stereotype threat. In academia, a grad student finishes their PhD, goes on to an academic position. And I don't know if there's specific training for them that is pedagogic in the sense of getting this sort of culturally aware training about stereotype threat and implicit bias. So as a dean and to other deans and people in positions of power within their institutions, is there a way that you can bring a training to a department and have them really understand the impact that it has on their students so that you sort of solve the problem from the larger sense of how it can impact the students that go through their programs and wind up in companies and take sort of these biases with them into that culture there. So I guess it's an ask and of you to work and use your power as a dean to work to integrate more of these types of trainings and make them sort of required for people who are going to interact with students, either as instructors or as advisors, so that we can start to sort of solve the problem before it becomes a problem.
Right, an excellent point. And I can say there, I think some universities, including Texas A&M in the College of Engineering, we've had discussions about, I think there's a report, I think it's called Changing the Dialogue or Changing the Conversation. And that is looking at the language that you use and how to change that conversation and dialogue such that you are more engaging of diverse students in terms of having that training go to the faculty. So I know in some universities do have the training for the faculty. At Texas A&M, we're actually having conversations about having the faculty training and faculty orientation to actually look at those issues in terms of the implicit bias and stereotype and how to change that conversation. At Texas A&M, there's also with the mediation training. So the mediation training is something that they advocate for all administrators at Texas A&M. It is voluntary. Where you sign up, but you're strongly encouraged to participate, and it talks also about the conversation and the language that you're using. So there is some of that going on at universities, but a lot more is needed. So that is an excellent challenge.
I'd like to give a shout out to NCWID and ABI, who have, NCWID has Male Allies and Advocates. It's a research report with stories from men who have become advocates. There's the sitwithme.org campaign that I think NCWID has also driven, and now this Women Technologists Count research report from ABI. Great reading to take back to your managers and department chairs.
So excellent. And so maybe and I guess one question would be, is looking at collective resources related to diversity in terms of computing. And so that would be really good as you brought up a number of good resources. Thank you. Okay, I went back over here.
Hi, my name is Arthi. I work at GE. I have a question that actually follows kind of well from the previous question. But a lot of what you've talked about is strategies for dealing with when people make explicit what their biases and stereotypes are. But one question I have is, how do you deal with situations where it's not explicit? It's not, you know, my manager won't let me do X, Y, or Z, and I can't point to a specific situation where their biases are affecting me, but over time, you know, people are making assumptions about you. They're not saying they're making those assumptions about you, but it's tiring.
Right. And sometimes you end up, it's not where somebody approaches you, but sometimes you may approach someone else and just have a conversation. And just to start off, you may start off a conversation, it's just to let you know a little bit about myself. And also starting off with, here's what I bring to the table. Because in some cases, it's not where a person is taking the time to see what everyone's bringing to the table, and things get overlooked. And so sometimes it's that initiative where you're taking that initiative to say, here's what I'm bringing to the table. Here's my background that I'm offering. So for example, at Texas A&M, so we have a new dean, Kathy Banks, and she's the first woman dean of the College of Engineering. And so with respect to the dean, with Commandit, they provide some support for Commandit. So I took the initiative to talk with Kathy Banks and tell her all about what Commandit was doing and to bring that to the table. And so it was my initiative, and I think after that, we started having more dialogue about diversity and what it means. So sometimes it takes you bringing it to the table. And I do want to mention, too, the value of mentors, because it's been mentioned throughout. And mentors are also very helpful, especially in a work environment and understanding the political structure. So I do want to mention that. Okay. Oh, I'm back over here.
Hi, my name's Annabelle. I'm from Amazon. And my question is that oftentimes those who are in the positions of power, who are favored by the existing power structures, favored by the monoculture, look at diversity as a pretty buzzword or, at worst, a threat. Mm-hmm. So my question is, how do we convince them that these processes, the engagement, all of this is worthwhile? It doesn't just benefit us, it benefits them, it benefits their company, their organization, it benefits everybody.
So that is a good question, and it's one that I've struggled with. And I remember it was at, I think it was Hopper in Vancouver, where one person, it was a speaker there, and we talked about this issue, and she mentioned to me, which was really good advice, and that is get to know what's their priority. So what are the things that matter to them most? And it's only going to be like the top three things. Then as you talk about the diversity, she said, while it's passionate for you, you have to present a case from their perspective where it becomes valuable to their priorities. So that was really helpful in terms of how to present a case with respect to diversity. So in some cases, it may be, how can this help my profit? And the profit may be in terms of the base that you work with your customer base, and looking at the demographics of your customer base, because then it becomes a profit issue. When you're in an educational environment, you're looking at your student base and the demographics of your students, and that's undergraduate and graduate students, and also how that plays with retention and with the faculty and their involvement. So you start to look at what are the critical top priorities and how to present your argument in a way that matches their top priorities. Because initially I was presenting it as how it matches to my passion, but realizing not everybody has that same perspective. A lot of people don't. And so it's the case of presenting it in such a way. And
thank you.
So I think I have time for one more question, is what I'm getting a signal.
Hello, my name is Naida Santiago.
Hi, Naida.
From the University of Puerto Rico. I want to find out if there are some strategies for dealing with prejudice in the classroom. Students usually don't talk about the prejudice, but sometimes I notice that they are prejudiced against women in the classroom or persons who, different types of prejudice. So what strategies can I use in my classroom?
And I'll give you some based upon some experiences, because I've seen that where sometimes in my class there may be two women in a class, and I look at the interaction that's going on, and as an instructor, I take note and actually try to change the interaction. And that is, I look at the questions, and I'll talk to them beforehand, so that I don't just isolate them and make them feel uncomfortable in the class. So we may have a discussion before, because I want to know about the students, especially the women, what's going on and what would be comfortable so that they're comfortable in the class. So I'll have that discussion with them before class, and then we'll talk through what I can do in the classroom so they're feeling more comfortable, and what I can do to help with the situation. So it's not, I would say, a one size or one solution, but it's working with the students that are being, I would say, put on attack in the classroom and doing what feels comfortable for the students.
Thank you.
So I've been given the notice, but I will be around. So I do want to say thank you very much for having an engaging dialogue about diversity. I really appreciate it, and it is truly my passion. So thank you very much.